Good afternoon, everybody. It's really a pleasure for me to be here today. I would like to thank Professor Rasmussen for organizing this tour. In my speech of today, I will cover. I will start with some basics for those of you who are not working in the field of, in particular, of coding. And so I will spend 10-15 minutes on some basics, and then I will move to the argument that is indicated in the slide here. So, some basics about codes and codes on graph and low density parity check codes. And so we'll spend a few minutes about channel coding, and in particular about low density parity check codes. And I will say something about iterative decoding, and I will also say something about packet erasure correcting codes, because these are of interest for the second part of the talk, that is about ALOHA and the possibility to use error correction together with ALOHA. So channel coding, all we know that digital communication, we have errors when we want to transmit some information, and error correcting codes, so all we know that are adopted to correct and or to detect, in some cases, bit errors. The principle in order to correct or detect errors is to add some redundancy. Shannon channel coding theorem is the foundation of our theory about error correcting codes, because it says exactly what is the efficiency that we can reach and what is the relation between the redundancy and the efficiency of our correcting strategy. In the encoding, for the encoding part, we assume that we have a binary, for example, code, and we assume that we have k bits of information that you want to transmit. These k bits enter into an encoder. We assume that we have a block encoder here, and we assume that the output of the encoder, there is a code word, what is called a code word, that is composed by n bits. And the code rate is the ratio between the number of information bits at the input of the encoder and the number of bits that compose one code word at the output of the encoder. For linear block codes, there is a linear relation between the, the encoder output vector C and the vector at the input of the encoder U. The linear relation is given by this expression, C equal to U times G, where G is the so-called generator matrix of the linear block code. And this generator matrix is a K by N matrix. Equivalently, we can say that all the code words in our code must satisfy this equation, H times C transpose equal to zero, where H is the so-called parity check matrix. And this matrix is a N minus K times N matrix that is related to the matrix G, the generator matrix, via this relation here. G times H transpose is equal to zero. These are quite elementary aspects about linear block coding. For the decoding, we know that what the decoder should do, once the decoder receives a vector Y, vector of received symbols, y1, y2, up to yn, the decoder has to find among all possible code words the code word that is more likely has given rise to the received symbol y. So the decoding is a decision problem. We can have hard decoding or soft decision decoding. So this is quite the usual way to see linear block codes. And more recently, Instead of using the matrix G and the matrix H in order to describe a code, we also use some graphs. So linear block codes can be described by using bipartite graphs. For example, like here, we have here a classical Hamming code, a 7-4 Hamming code. That means that we have four information bits that are encoded into a code word of 7 bits. The 7 bits must satisfy the equation that we gave before. C transpose must be equal to 0. So for each code word, it must be that H time C, C is a column vector in this expression here, must be 0. So if we have this matrix here, we have that this row times C must be equal to 0, and the second row times the vector C must be equal to 0, the third row times the vector C must be equal to 0. So this, actually, each of these three rows can be also expressed in terms of equations, because since the product between this row and the vector C must be 0, this means that C1 plus C4 plus C5 plus C7 must be equal to 0. And also from the second row, we see that C2 plus C4 plus C6 plus C7 must be equal to 0. And also the third row tells us that C3 plus C5, C6, and C7 must be equal to 0. So actually, the parity check matrix H is describing a constraint on the symbols, on the code word symbols. And we can have an equivalent description of the matrix H by giving explicitly three equations that correspond, each equation is corresponding to one row of this H. Another way to describe the same constraint is to give a bipartite graph like this. On the left, we represent the variable nodes, what we call the variable nodes. Each variable node is associated to 1 bit of the code word. And on the right, we represent what are called check nodes. Each nodes here is representing a row of the matrix H, or if you like, one equation here in this constraint. So this first check node is representing the first row of H, or equivalently, the first equation in this system of equations here. How do we read this bipartite graph? We see that in the first equation, we have C1, C4, C5, and C7. That is exactly the first equation here. So we connect the check node with the variable nodes that are in the equation described by the check node. And similarly, for the second check node, we have C2 plus C4 plus C6 plus C7. That is exactly the second equation, or the second row of H, and so on. So this way is another way to represent the constraint that is given by the parity check equation H. This sometimes is called tunnel graph, and is an equivalent representation of the channel matrix H. So, for those of you who are working with the graphs, we can see here that, for example, in this case, there is a cycle here in this graph. And when there are cycles in these kind of graphs, we can have some problems in the decoding process, as we will see later. So, the reason for using coding is to improve the performance of our transmission. I will skip this one. I will also skip this one. Low-density parity check codes are a particular class of block codes. These are quite old codes, have been invented by Robert Gallagher in 1960, and then there are some other contribution for the low-density parity check codes that are here indicated. Tanner, 1981. And then more recent works on low density parity check codes up to our days. And these codes are very interesting because it is possible to get very good performance from these codes with quite a feasible implementation. By definition, a sparse binary matrix is a matrix with a low density of ones, like here. And a low density parity check code is simply a linear block code where the parity check matrix H is sparse. So there is a small number of ones and a larger number of zeros. Since the matrix H is sparse, this means that also the bipartite graph that is associated to the matrix H is sparse. That means that there are few connections, few edges. The number of nodes on the left is the number of valuable nodes is equal to the number of columns of the matrix H. And on the right, the number of check nodes is equal to the number of rows of the matrix H, because each check variable check node represents an equation here, that is a row of H. Also for these kind of codes, we have some definition. We have the check node degree. The check node degree is the number of edges connecting to a check node. For example, here, this is a check node, what we call a check node. This check node has a node degree equal to one. There is just one edge here. There is another check node here with the degree two, and so on. So we have degrees both for the check nodes and for the variable nodes on the left, similarly. We have regular low-density parity check codes. An LDPC is called regular if the check node degree and the variable node degree are constant, and otherwise is said to be irregular. This is a classification of low-density parity check codes. The invention of the low-density, the original idea by Professor Gallagher is about regular low-density parity check codes. Then there are other way to design regular low-density parity check codes, for example, based on finite geometry. There are also irregular low-density parity check codes that can be computer-generated or based on protographs, for example. What is important in low-density parity check code is that usually it is quite difficult to study a specific low-density parity check code. These low-density parity check codes are usually very large, with the code words that are very large. It is much better to work in terms of ensembles. So in LDPC codes, usually we specify some common properties of the codes, and we study the expected behavior of codes that are picked randomly within a given set with some specific characteristics. For example, the Gallagher's regular ensemble, that means once we have decided what is the degree for the check node, and once we have decided what are the degrees for the variable nodes, for example, we have several different ways to connect the nodes. And if we look at statistically to the ensemble of all possible codes that we can get, we have some very useful insights also for designing the code. So we have the Gallagher's regular ensemble, some unstructured irregular ensemble, some protograph ensemble, multi-edge type ensemble, and so on. One of the important properties of low-density parity check codes is that they are quite simple to decode with simple strategies. In particular, we can use iterative decoding. And this iterative decoding is in this case is known as the sum product decoder. Essentially, what the decoder does in this case is to exchange some information along the edges from the variable nodes on the left to the check nodes to the right, and then back from the check nodes to the variable nodes from the right to the left. And by properly choosing these messages that these nodes are exchanging, it is possible to decode the transmitted code word. I think I don't have time to enter into the iterative decoding algorithm for low-density parity check codes. I will just give you a practical example. The example is here on the board. I don't know if you can see this. This is an example of code with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 bits and the three equations, three parity check equations. Actually, this is an Hamming code. And we assume that from the channel we are receiving some bits. And we want to decode the received bits. And we assume that the channel is the so-called erasure channel. That means that what we get from the channel can be correct, and we know that it is correct, or can be a question mark. That means that we don't know what is the symbol associated. So in this case, for example, from the channel, we receive a 1 for this first bit. So we know that this bit is a 1. From the channel, we get a 0. So we know that this bit is a 0. From the channel, we got a question mark for the third bit. And this means that we don't know what is this bit. Can be a 0 or a 1, but we don't know. Same thing for the next bit. And same thing for the next bit. So we have three question marks. And then we have another 1 coming from the channel. We know that this is a 1. And we know that this is a 1. So this is the information that we got from the channel. This is question mark, three question marks, and four correct bits that we get from the channel. Now we have to find the question marks. We have to solve this problem here. What can we do? This is a very elementary iterative decoding. So we know from here that these four bits must sum to 0, because this is a parity check. We know that this bit plus this plus this plus this must be 0. Okay, this is a precious information. Let's see what kind of information we have. We know that this is a 1. We know that this is a 0. We know that this one is a 1 coming from the bottom. So we have a 1 here on this edge. So about this first equation, we have 1, 0, question mark, and 1. So since we know that the sum must be 0, we can correct, we can decide about this question mark. Okay? 1, 0, question mark, and 1. The sum must be 0, of course, in binary, in the binary field. And so we know that we can decide that this is a 0. This is a 0. Okay? 1, 0, 0, 1, sum up to 0. So we have exchanged some information coming from the channel. We have passed this information to these little nodes. This little node, with the information coming from the variable node, can solve this ambiguity, the ambiguity about this bit here. So we know now that this is a 0. Let's look to the other for the other equation here. In this other equation, we have a 0 coming from this. We have a 0 coming from the second correction here. We have a question mark here. And we have a 1 here. So again, by looking at the constraint that we have, we know that the sum must be 0. And we can solve for the question mark again. even in this case. So if you look at this problem, you start exchanging information from the left to the right, and you see that it is possible to solve the three unknowns here quite easily. So essentially, iterative decoding works like this. You have some information that comes from the channel, and you send this information from the variable node to the check nodes. The check nodes, they do something, and they try to solve the ambiguities or to improve reduce the ambiguities, and they send back to the left the new information that they have. And iteratively, this can solve the problem for the decoding process. It's very roughly. So another concept that we will use in the second part of the talk is the concept of doubly generalized low-density parity check codes. We have seen before that here, essentially, here we have that these nodes represent, the variable nodes represent the bits of the code word, and the edge are connecting the variable node to the check nodes here. And these nodes here can be thought of as repetition codes. Indeed, indeed here it is like if the bit C5 is sent to this check node and to this check node. So in this structure, in the normal low-density parity check code, this node can be seen as a repetition code because the symbol C5 is repeated in all edges. On the right side, we know that the sum of all bits connected to this check node must be zero. And this means that these check nodes can be thought of as single parity check codes, where we have to maintain the parity of all the incoming bits. All the incoming bits must sum to zero. So this structure can be generalized. Can be generalized, and indeed, what we can do in the so-called doubly generalized low-density parity check codes is to replace the repetition code that we have for the variable node with some generic variable node, what we call generalized variable node. That means that the bits received from the message that we want to encode are sent to a node that indeed is a small encoder. And so this small encoder, instead of repeating the same information as for the usual low-density parity check codes, we have more than one bit sent to one of these big nodes. And this big node produces N1 edges, and these N1 edges are representing a code word or a small block code. So indeed, we can replace the repetition codes for the variable node and the single parity check codes for the check nodes with more general block codes, both for the variable nodes and for the check nodes. This is the so-called concept of double generalized low-density parity check codes. The last basic idea that we need in order to talk about coded slotted ALOHA is the packet erasure codes. Up to now, we have seen that the message that we want to transmit is composed of k bits, but actually we can do the same even if the message that we want to transmit is composed by packets. And so we have this idea of packet erasure correcting codes. So we can have this situation we have k packets to be transmitted. We assume that we have k packets of the same length, for example, 6 packets. We can add 3, for example, in this case, 3 checksum packets, what we call checksum packets. So we add 3 checksum packets and we send these, that is a, for us it is a code word, it is a code word, we send these to the channel. The channel is usually a packet erasure channel in the sense that these packets, as seen from the upper layers, can be received correctly, either correctly, or with a wrong CRC, for example. In this case, we discard the packet, or they cannot arrive at all. And in this case, we have, in any case, we have an erasure, what we call an erasure. So if we look at the problem of transmitting packets from the upper layers in the stack, the protocol stack, we see that there are some packets that are sent through the lower layers. Sometimes the packets coming from the lower layers to the upper layers are lost for some reasons. And so we can model the process as a packet erasure channel. And so at the other side, this is what we send from one side. At the other side, we receive some correcting some packets, and we are going to lose some of the packets here with the cross. And we can apply the same idea, the same tricks that we have used here for the bits, even for the packets. It's very easy. And so actually what we can do is to recover lost packets instead of lost bits. So the same approach that we can use for the bits, we can also use for the packets. For the packet erasure codes, the advantages are the following. The packet erasure codes can be added in software without changing the physical layer. This is very important. We have some implementation at several gigabits per second implemented in software of these systems where we add the packet error correction at the upper layers in the protocol stack. This can work with the very long code words. These packet erasure codes can work with the very long code words because the elements of the code now are packets, and each packet can be 1,000 bits, for example. So we can cover very long time. For example, in a satellite application, this can be useful in order to recover the loss of packets due to synchronization, to the loss of synchronization. And this can replace ARQ in delay constraint scenario or when there is no feedback channel. And these packet erasure codes are included in some new standards. So this is quite quickly just to give some ideas about codes. And then we start with the real presentation. So I'm going to speak about the connection between codes on graphs and random access, actually. So what is the scope of this work is to improve the throughput in the random access schemes by exploiting, again, some of the concepts that they tried very roughly to talk before. So we called this scheme coded slotted ALOHA. And there are some ideas that we borrowed from the low-density parity check codes, and we moved into the random access world in order to improve the random access performance. So about random access, all we know about the famous ALOHA, that is the first and most important random access scheme. Slotted ALOHA is very important. It's currently adopted as the initial access scheme in many communication systems, both cellular and satellite. An improvement to slotted ALOHA is named diversity slotted ALOHA. This diversity slotted ALOHA is not recent, in 1983 from Choudhury. Here the idea is to repeat the packets. Instead of transmitting just one packet as in the slotted ALOHA, is to repeat the same packet twice, so to have a twin replica. And in some condition with the when we have low loads in the system, this can give you a slight advantage in terms of throughput. But a real breakthrough idea came more recently, in our opinion, and this is given by this scheme that is called Contention Resolution Diversity Slotted ALOHA. And the paper is 2007 from Casini, De Gaudenzi, and De Rio Herrero. The paper title is here indicated. In contention resolution diversity slotted ALOHA, we will see that there is also the idea of using, together with the twin replicas to repeat twice the packet, there is the idea of using interference cancellation. And this gives a very large improvement in terms of throughput. And then there is a generalization of contention resolution diversity slotted ALOHA. That is the irregular repetition slotted ALOHA, is IRSA, more recent, 2011. What is the basic idea? Basic idea is the following. Here we have the case of slotted ALOHA. In slotted ALOHA, this is the frame. We assume that we have a given number of slots, NSA slots, and we have several users. What happens here, that we know that in slotted ALOHA, whenever a user has something to transmit, it transmits. So for example, user one has to transmit a packet, it transmits his packet in this slot. User two has a packet to transmit, it transmits in this slot. User three has a packet to transmit, it picks randomly another slot and chooses this slot, and so on. Unfortunately, in this slot, user one and three are having a collision. So we assume that these two packets are lost due to the collision. This is the slotted ALOHA. In this case, when we have collision, you have to retransmit the packet with some backoff. So what is the idea in collision resolution diversity slotted ALOHA? The idea is very smart, is to repeat the packet twice. So we have user number one, he wants to transmit a packet, he repeats twice the same packet, here and here. And in each packet, there is a pointer to the position of the other packet. So in this packet here, there is a pointer giving the position to the other twin replica of the same packet. And the same thing for user two. So user two chooses randomly two time slots and repeat the same packet twice, here and here, and so on. Now, again, we have some collisions here. We have a collision here. We have a collision here. We have a collision here. And now the idea, how can we improve now the system, the throughput with respect to the previous case here? Now, the trick is the following. Okay. Let's try to use this information about the position of the other packet and to remove the interference to the other packet in case of collision. So, for example, in this case, we see that we have this packet that is without collision. There is no collision here. So the decoder can start from this packet. This packet can be decoded can be received correctly. And once you get this packet, you also, there's a pointer to the other packet, this one. Once you get this, you know what is the content of this other packet, and you know the position of this other packet. So you can, in this lot, you have the same post received, you can remove this packet. You can remove, if you know the channel, you know the content, you can remove the contribution of this packet here. And so you solve this collision. So this is not anymore a collision after this, because we have cancelled out, by using interference cancellation, the contribution of this slot. Okay, so we start from here. This is clean, so no problem. We decode this, we look at the pointer, we know that here there is a twin packet. In this slot, we have the same post with the collision, but we can remove the contribution of this packet. We remove the contribution of this packet, then we have cleaned this one. Once we have this one, we have the pointer to the other one. So we can go here, and we can remove the yellow part here, and we can recover this one. Once we have this one, we have the pointer to the other one, and we can remove the collision, remove the contribution, the interference caused by this packet, and we can get the last one. So iteratively, this is very similar to what we do in low-density parity check codes. Iteratively, we can try to remove the collisions that we have in our system. So again, for this case, the situation is like this. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4 users here, and we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 slots. Okay, so we can represent, like for the low-density parity check codes, the slots with some nodes. Here we have 7 slots, and we have 4 users. 1, 2, 3, 4 users. So we want to use a kind of a graphs representation of the process. What happens here? The first user is transmitting in the slot number 4 and number 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. This is the first user. The second user, user number 2, is transmitting in slot 2 and 7 again. Collision. User number 3, position 3. And sorry, the two, this was wrong. The two was in 2 and 4. Okay. Number 3 and 7. Number 4 in slot 2 and slot 5. Okay, this is an equivalent representation of what happens in this case. And we have nodes describing the users and nodes describing the slots. And we have collisions here. We see that for this slot we have 2 packets, so we have a collision. Clean slot, nobody is transmitting here. Just 1 packet, so no collision here. Collision, no collision, collision, nothing. Okay, but then we can start using our decoding algorithm from the clean slots. From here, for example, this is a slot where we don't have any collision, so we can recover the corresponding packet. And so we go down. So we know the packet transmitted by the user number 4. So if we know this packet, we also know this one, so we can remove this edge in our notation. What does it mean, removing this edge? Means removing the contribution of the second packet of the user number 4, for example. So we start from the nodes here represented the slots, and we go down and we remove the packets, producing the collisions and the we decode this one, so we can remove this one, because we remove the second packet, since we know what is the position of the second packet. Then we have solved also this, we can remove this, we can remove this, and so on and so forth. So anyway, moving iteratively through this graph, we can solve the collision in this case. So the system model is the following. We have M users, each attempting to transmit a packet within a MAC frame. We have normalized offered traffic or channel traffic that is quite usual for this literature. It's the number of users divided by the number of slots that represent the average number of packet transmissions per slot. And we define the normalized throughput T as the probability of successful packet transmission per time slot. So by using interference cancellation to resolve collision, what I tried to explain before, so the idea is the following. Each of the transmitted twin replicas has a pointer to the slot position of the copy. If a packet is detected and successfully decoded, the pointer is extracted and the interference is removed, and the procedure is iterated. If you look what we can get from this, the throughput is around 0.55. That is an enormous throughput with respect to slotted ALOHA. We know that in slotted ALOHA the maximum throughput is 0.37. What is the drawback of this scheme is that each packet is transmitted twice. So we are spending twice as much power as for slotted ALOHA, if we neglect the retransmission, of course. So the irregular repeat slotted ALOHA is an improvement of the previous scheme, where we, instead of having a repetition two, so each packet is repeated twice each time, we allow variable repetition rate for each packet. So instead of using repetition 2, we can use sometimes repetition 3 or 5. And under the assumption of a sufficiently large signal-to-noise ratio, the process is described by a bipartite graph, as I tried to describe before. And there are a lot of commonalities with the tools that we have from low-density parity check codes literature. And we can get very good performance. Another improvement is, instead of using here in this scheme, is like to use a repetition code of with a repetition rate 2. Each packet is transmitted twice. Okay, what if instead of using a repetition 2 code, we use a generic code, a more general code? This is what we call the coded slotted ALOHA. In coded slotted ALOHA, the packet to be sent is subdivided in sub-packets, and these sub-packets are encoded by a linear packet-level erasure correcting code, and this is picked randomly from a given set of candidate codes, all codes with the same dimension for simplicity, and these sub-packets are transmitted over NH slots picked at random. Again, we can use the same trick of iterative decoding to get rid of the collisions. So this is an example. In this case, the user 1, instead of repeating 3 times the same packet, I have a packet with some information. I divided the packet in 2 pieces, and I add another piece. So I have a 3-2 block code. I added one parity packet out of 2 information packets. So I have a rate 2/3 code for the first user. For the second user, out of 2 pieces of information packets, I add 2 parity sub-packets. So I have a rate 2/4, 1/2. And so on. I can change the rate of the codes that I use for the different users. This is generalized the previous scheme and also allows me to save some power, because instead of repeating, and when I use the repetition code, I have to use at least repetition rate 2. I can use a rate 2/3 or rate 4/5 or something similar. I can save some power. So the assumptions that we made is that we have a sufficiently high signal-to-noise ratio, and this means that whenever a packet is received in a clean slot, the decoding error probability is zero. We assume also ideal channel estimation. That means that the recovering collided packets with the probability that is one. Under this assumption, we can use the tools of codes on graphs in order to design also the best distributions for the codes that we have to use for the different users. And indeed, this is similar to the concept of doubly generalized latency part check codes that I described before. It is possible also to see that when we are in the asymptotic setting, that is the number of time slots is very large and the number of users is very large, we can analyze the behavior of the iterative interference cancellation scheme by using density evolution. And we have also the so-called threshold phenomenon. That means that for values of the traffic G, of the traffic G below a certain threshold, the iterative interference cancellation will succeed with the probability close to 1. And for values of G above a given threshold that we can find, the procedure will fail with the probability always bounded away from 0. And so there are ways to find what is this threshold for a given scheme that we are using. Actually, it's possible to find this threshold by some tools taken from density evolution. And actually, the threshold is equal to the smallest G satisfying the equation that are reported here. Anyway, there are ways to analyze the threshold of this scheme. Just to give you some numbers, some examples, here we have the threshold. This G star is the threshold, essentially, the maximum offered traffic that we can try to deal with in our system. The threshold here, for example, is we see with the rate 1/3, we have a rate 0.88, for example. If we increase the rate, we have a rate 1/2. With the scheme employing only repetition codes, we have a G star that is equal to 0.5. If we use coded slot at ALOHA, where we allow also the use of different block codes, different from repetition codes, we can have larger values for the rates and for the law of the throughput. I will show you here what is the situation. Oh, this is the throughput. This is the simulation result for a finite number m of users. We have optimized the degree profiles of the codes. And here we have some result. Here we have the throughput as a function of the traffic G. And this red here is the curve for the slotted ALOHA. Classical curve for the slotted ALOHA. We have a maximum 0.37. And then we know that the curve goes down. And we also know for the slotted ALOHA that There is some problem of stability for the scheme. And these are the results for the scheme employing these tricks, the coded slotted ALOHA system and the irregular repeat slotted ALOHA systems. And we see here, for example, that if we have coded slotted ALOHA with rate 1/2, we have this behavior of the throughput as a function of G, very linear, and the maximum throughput is very, very high compared to slotted ALOHA. So we have two different advantages in using this scheme here. One is that the throughput that we can get is very high compared to that of slotted ALOHA. We see here the maximum is very high, 0.8. In theory, we can also go farther to larger values. And the second aspect, very important aspect, is that you see that this curve here is the curve S equal to G. That means that there is no loss in the packets. That means that there is no need for retransmission. Because if we are working in this part, this is the curve S equal to G. This means that all the packets that we are sending are successfully decoded. So we don't need to retransmit the packets. We have no collisions. I mean, we have collisions, but we can solve the collision by using the tricks of iterative decoding and interference cancellation that I've shown you before. That means that we don't need to have to deal with the retransmission of packets, all of lost packets. As soon as we are on this line, S is equal to G, that means that all the offered traffic becomes useful throughput. This is quite remarkable because this means that we don't need to have any system to inform the station that the packet has been lost and that you need to retransmit the packet. So actually, if we are working here, the coded slotted ALOHA does not need retransmission. This is the reason why we don't need a retransmission, because all the packets that are sent are successfully recovered at the end of the iterative decoding and interference cancellation. Okay, this is the result. For practical results, I mean, the question now is the following. Okay, but how close are these curves to the real diagonal? Because if this can be 10 to the minus 2, so that means that some packets are lost. Actually, if we look carefully, these are some results. And these are results in terms of packet loss rate here as a function of G. And we have here that for this case, the distribution that we designed as a threshold that is 0.977, this line here, and but this threshold is a theoretical threshold for an infinite number, very large number of slots and the users, and we compare this with the curve that we can have when we have a finite number of slots, up to 500 slots, and the maximum number of iteration in our process, the coding process, set to 100, and we see that even with 500 time slots, still we have a very good performance, and the throughput that we can, the load that we can deal with is around 0.7, 0.8 easily, still with very low packet loss rate. So this works even in the realistic setting. Finally, we have studied what is the finite limit that we can find for this G star, the offered traffic that we can, this threshold that we can have with our system. And, it is possible in it is possible to show that the threshold is given by the unique positive solution of this equation, the unique positive solution G of this equation, once we have fixed the R, this is related to the rate of the codes that we are using. And so there is also a plane of G versus the rate R of the codes that we are using, and there is a non-achievable region, and there are some points that correspond to the practical codes that we are using. These points here correspond to our codes, the codes that we found in our analysis. And so we see that we, in some cases, we are quite close to the limit. In other cases, we are far to the limit and we have still to work. But the interesting thing is that there is a limit. And so we can decide if our code is good or not. Conclusion, this code is not the law. The idea is the following. Each packet is divided into sub-packets, encoded through a linear packet erasure correcting code. There is an iterative interference cancellation that is performed on sub-packets and combined with the local erasure correction capability of each packet. There are several aspects in common with the codes on graph and the low density parity check codes over erasure channel. In terms of system, we see that we have a forward error correction. That is the case where we add some redundancy in order to correct the errors at the destination. And in contrast to forward error correction, there are all the techniques for requesting retransmission of packets. And we can say that the code slotted ALOHA is somewhat a similar relation with the slotted ALOHA. In code slotted ALOHA, we are using some codes on the packets that we want to transmit. And the nice thing about the code slotted ALOHA is that we don't need to have a feedback channel. We just send our packets as they are. We don't care because in most of the cases, all the packets are successfully recovered, and so we don't need retransmission. And the other important aspect is that with this technique, we have a throughput that is very high compared to that of slotted ALOHA. And indeed, we have an efficiency of near to one packet per slot without retransmission by using proper coding. So I think that this ends my presentation. I would like to thank you for your attention.